This episode of Fireside Chat is brought to you by Robert Woodward, lawyer at Altador Law. He specializes in family law, wills, and estates for Flame fans in Calgary and Southern Alberta. Call Robert at 403-771-2187 and mention Fireside Chat to get $100 off any legal service.
Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another Fireside Chat, the official podcast of Flames fans. It's go time.
The longest losing streak of the season has finally come to an end after a big home win against the Vegas Golden Knights. And as always, I'm Dan, and I'm here with Matt, and we're going to break down what happened this week and looking ahead to the next week for the Flames. Matt, should we jump right into the Maple Leafs game?
Sure, why not?
We broadcast during this game last week, and it didn't look as dire as I think it ended up being when we were done. But big slaughter from Toronto here with a 6-2 win over the Calgary Flames.
Yeah, it was not a pretty game.
Is there much to say in this one besides, you know what, maybe one of the few games this season David Riddick hasn't looked really good in?
Well, honestly, like, other than that fifth goal, the hat trick goal for Tyler Ennis, like, the other goals, like, the first three goals that he surrendered in the first period, he didn't really have much of a chance on any of them because the defense was playing so poorly. And then giving up the fourth one early in the second, and that was the night right there. And Flames didn't really have any pushback whatsoever. And it, like, I can't really blame Riddick solely on those goals. Like, you give anybody the time and space like they did with Ennis on the first goal or Hyman on the third goal. Like, you just can't. And it is what it is.
Something we haven't said for a while is the Toronto Maple Leafs are a good hockey team.
And they'll lose in the first round of the Boston Bruins.
But, I mean, they finally, you know, for years it was kind of the known rule, I guess, around the league that they could be as crappy as they want to. They're still going to sell tickets. But they're looking good right now. They're going to be in cap troubles in a couple of years, so they might as well enjoy it while they can.
True. It'll be interesting to see that. I'm actually kind of curious to see if Toronto can actually pass both Calgary and San Jose. So that way, like, the three best teams in the NHL will all be in the same division just to screw everything up.
I don't think it's going to happen.
No.
On Wednesday, the Flames hopped on a plane to Vegas and they went on their longest road trip of the month, which is weird to say, being only two games. But they had a quick back-to-back on the road. They played against the Vegas Knights in T-Mobile Arena. Didn't look great. Looked like they ran out of gas at the end of this one, I think, and ended up losing 2-1 to the Golden Knights. Your thoughts on this, Matt?
That waved off goal due to goaltender interference, to me, was one of the single worst calls I've seen in a long time. If a goalie sticks his stick into a player and then it gets caught up in that player, that's his own fault. And that costs the Flames the game. So, like, and he made the first save anyway. I really don't agree with that call whatsoever. And it's hard to overcome both the referees and the opposition. And frankly, some of the penalty calls early in the game were not consistently called throughout the game, again to the Flames' detriment, and it just seemed like a very chintzy effort by the referees in this one. And I'm not one to criticize the referees too much, but like, this was a particularly bad game from
them. With all those things you mentioned, the Flames just looked like they gave up by the end. Like, in the third period, they just seemed like they weren't playing anymore. They really didn't care anymore.
Well, it's hard when you're expecting to get certain calls. You know, like the Gaudreau interference play where he got hit when he didn't have the puck. That's pretty much as blatant as you get. And yet that was let go. And, you know, the Flames should have had a power play with less than 5 minutes to go. Perhaps they tie it up. But instead, stuff like that wasn't called. And yet the Flames were on the other end of that in the first period. And it just, it's hard to be able to beat both the refs and the opposition, and that was more of the case in this game. And the Flames should have been better and should have fought through it. It's just that this was a particularly bad game from the referees. And usually, like, there might be only one or two really bad games from the referees in a season, and this was one.
What I don't like is when you have a game like that where the team obviously got demoralized by the end, and as you mentioned, rightly so, and then you've got to play again the next night. I don't think there's enough mental time there for the team to sort of snap out of it and get back to where they need to be. And I think that was a lot of what happened the next night. Calgary went to play the Arizona Coyotes. I still want to say Phoenix, but the Arizona Coyotes, and ended up losing again for their fourth in a row, 2-0 to the Coyotes.
So the Los Angeles Coyotes of Arizona.
There you go. Again, I think that some of those things from the night before, the team looked kind of lackluster here. I didn't think that they looked like they were ready to play. It probably is because they were deflated the night before.
You have games like this where you could tell they were on a losing streak and mentally they weren't in it. And it's frustrating because, you know, like, we definitely could have used the 2 points. But Arizona, they're fighting for their lives, really. They're right up in, I think, 9th right now in the Western Conference and close to a playoff spot. So, like, they're definitely fighting to get into the playoffs. And, of course, they're not going to be being passengers. Like, they're going to want to try and sneak into the postseason. And that they just, the Flames didn't really have a response at all. And the first two lines, frankly, were both terrible in this game. And I think basically it was just the Derek Ryan line with Eat Bread and Hathaway that were doing anything.
The Coyotes wanted more than we did.
Yep.
I think that's about all we can say about this one.
Well, that's the thing. Like, the Flames do have an easy schedule in terms of the quality of opponents, but you have teams that have nothing to do other than play spoiler or are fighting for their playoff lives. So Calgary can't take any of these teams lightly, even though some of the teams are less talented.
Yeah, for sure. And I think, you know, even when you're out of the playoffs, a lot of times, and we've even seen this in the past with the Flames, if you want to play spoiler, right? You want to come out and show, yeah, we can beat that team that's at the top of the West. So even though, like you said, it's maybe a better schedule than some of our opponents, these teams still want to prove that they can do this.
Well, plus players on those teams are fighting for jobs for next season and all that kind of stuff as well, so... You know, you're not going to have any passenger teams the rest of the way, even though some of them, frankly, are not very good.
And then Calgary came home after that, had 2 days off. They took Friday, Saturday off, and then Sunday, the Vegas Knights rolled right back into playing us, this time in our barn. And I think we can credit both Tkachuk and Malcolm Subban for this win. The Calgary Flames got a big win to smash their 4-game win streak and also defeat Vegas's win streak. That was, 7 straight victories for them. Calgary won 6-3 in a big game. Couple notes here before I let you give your thoughts. Tkachuk gets his first NHL hat trick, and Michael Frolik ties his career high with 4 points in a game. So big game from that 3M line here.
Yeah, and frankly, to put one little criticism is that the first line still seems out of sequence, but at least the second, third, and fourth lines were playing extremely well throughout the contest.
And, you know, you and I have talked about that, right? Is that first line's not doing well, but somebody has to jump in and fill in for them, and we saw that here. I mean, Mangiapane opened the scoring quite early. His line looked good, and then really the rest of the night was the 3M show. And I'm hoping that this might be what gets Tkachuk going, because we need this Matthew Tkachuk for a playoff run.
Exactly. And he's been having chances just not go in for him of late. So him breaking through and getting a hat trick hopefully sparks him for a bit. And it was nice to see Johnny Gaudreau get 9 shots on net. Of course, there was only like 2 or 3 that were actually dangerous shots, but he needs to start to snap out of his funk, and taking a more proactive approach will do nothing but be beneficial moving forward, especially like once he gets one, I think he'll go on a bit of a roll after that. It's just, he needs to break through and get the first one.
Backlund got number 18 and 19 on the season, and Tkachuk got 27, 28, and 29. The other goal scorer here who opened the scoring early was Andrew Mangiapane. And Matt, you were saying before we started tonight, he's looking really good, isn't he?
Yeah, it's nice to see him being comfortable at the NHL level. And I think for the first 30 or so games of his career, he was just trying to not screw up more than anything. And he didn't want to have a situation like Quine did where one mistake ends up sending him to Stockton. And now he's getting a little bit more comfortable with how things are in the NHL, and he's performing a lot better. And frankly, he's looking more of like a top six forward who happens to be playing on the fourth line, which would be awesome, frankly, if he can emerge as a good second, third line guy moving forward.
Yeah, I don't know if that's going to happen, just looking at the depth on this team, but it would be nice.
Well, it's one of those things that with having so much depth on defense and in the forward ranks, the Flames could package a couple up for a better player and move a guy like Mangiapane up the lineup and not be overly concerned because of the fact that if he is going to emerge as a top six or top nine forward on the team, like, you could sacrifice someone else in a trade to get a more name guy to try and be a more of a cup contender caliber team and have him play an adequate role, say, on the third line or something like that.
I think Mangiapane is going to have to take somebody's job. Like you said, they're going to have to force the Flames' hand to make a move to bring Mangiapane up into the top six.
Yeah, and if you look at, like, relative value, like, he's not going to deliver you much, but a player that might be in a spot that he could take, realistically, might be able to do so to get you an upgrade elsewhere.
Yeah, for sure. So, just wanted to, I know, and we've talked about it before, after the longer, you know, Flames droughts that we've seen, but is the sky falling? And the question I got asked today is the sky done falling? So, I mean, if we look at what's happened after the four-game losing streak, the Flames are still a good team. It was really their first big struggle of the season. If Sunday's game against Vegas is the start of turning something around, great. They looked really good there. The Flames lost their first two back-to-back regulation games since November. So, you know, looking at all things and the way they are, this team's looking pretty good. They're still number one in the Pacific, and this is why it was so important that we built up that lead early, because I've told you since the beginning, we're going to struggle at some point, and we're going to need those points. So, I don't know about you, if you look at how much they traveled last month, like, these guys were on the road almost all month, so I think really all they needed was a little rest and a little home cooking. What about you, Matt?
Yeah, and I think that, like, losing the four in a row kind of sends, like, a message to the players of, you know, wake up and play better. And we saw that against Vegas the second time, where all four lines looked a lot better than they have been and more attentive to details. And that, if they can keep rolling with that, then the Flames should be fine the rest of the way. Especially because, like, other than games against Winnipeg, Columbus, and San Jose, like, there's not really any high-end opponents. Like, they do play Dallas and in the Honda Center once, but, you know, like, it's not, there's no real elite teams beyond those three. So, Calgary, like, if they have the fundamentals of their game going well and things start clicking like the Tkachuk line yesterday, then the team will be fine going through this stretch. It's just that they have to work for the points. And, you know, I don't think that anybody really wants to play Vegas in round one. And frankly, if I'm Vegas, I'd much rather play San Jose in round one, just because they're a little on the slower side, so that Vegas might have a better, easier time with San Jose than they would us anyway.
Looking at the rest of the month, the Flames have a couple 2-day breaks. They have the 13th, 14th off, the 17th, 18th off, and only three more road games this month. So really a lot of home games here, and I think this is where the team can, you know, be more on a regular schedule. They can get their practices in a bit better. And I'm hoping that, you know, such a big home swing and even the road trips. I mean, it's quick shot to Winnipeg, quick shot to Vancouver, really. You know, even those two games is not much of a road trip. You could be back in your bed that night if you wanted to. So I'm hoping this is where we'll see the team really come alive again.
Yeah, and at the end of the month, they have a 3-game and 4-night California trip.
And that's
the 31st, 1st, and 3rd. So, you know, it's not... And the difficult game is the first one, so when the team is fresh. So that helps as well.
Yeah, so I'm hoping that just, you know, being at home, having some home cooking and sleeping in their own bed, they've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 more home games this month of their 13 total. So I'm hoping that's going to help them get on a bit of a roll again.
Yeah, and one thing I'm glad for is that with there being 13 games remaining and a lot of average-ish opponents, that it allows the team to have the flexibility of having both starters play to figure out who do we want for game one in the postseason. And frankly, both guys have struggled at times recently, and both guys have been good lately as well. And having the ability to see which guy over the next couple weeks is going to be the guy, I think is going to be the most important thing. And, you know, like, ideally, the Flames will win the division and have to play the 8th seed guy instead of Vegas, but if it comes down to Vegas, we can beat them. It's just, you know, I'd rather go the easy route.
If frankly. You were the coach and the playoffs started today, who would be your starter?
Mike Smith.
And why? Why?
Experience, for one, and he's so good at playing the puck, save for that Ginla jersey retirement night, that it does screw up the other team. And like, if you're used to dumping the puck in at all as a strategy to attack, having a guy like Smith just going in, getting it, and firing it back out, it messes up your timing and forces you to do something different. And Riddick has notably improved since last season by practicing with Smith at it, but Smith is the best playmaking goalie in the NHL. So with both guys looking kind of below average at times lately and not very solid at times, I'd rather go with the guy who's at least taken a team to the conference finals before instead of a rookie who has been kind of okay for the longer term. He, like, basically since New Year, Riddick hasn't looked very good. So, you know, it's frustrating because you wish one guy would just run and take it, and I think that that's what we'll see over the next couple weeks.
I agree with you. If the playoffs started today and I was coaching this team, I'd start Smith. Couple reasons. One, like you mentioned, for the veteran experience. Two, I think the fact that he can play the puck a lot better, and Riddick tries to play the puck and doesn't do a good job. But I think, especially against a team like Vegas, Smith being able to play the puck is going to help this team out and give them a little bit more of an intangible inside their own zone.
I agree. And I think that, like, say the Flames do go on a bit of a playoff run, I expect the games to pretty much be split evenly. I'd expect that, like, if Smith, say, won, like, the first two games and then really struggled in the third one, that you'd go with Riddick for game four and see if he can go on a tear. And I think you'll see the team bounce back and forth between the two goalies.
See, I could see them try to get up, like, 3-1 in a series and then throw Riddick in the fourth game.
Yeah. We'll see. You know, like, it just depends on how the goalies perform.
What I think from here on out, though, we're talking about goalies, is I don't know how much juice we've got left in Smith's tank at this point. I think you've got to play him, but you've also got to conserve some of his energy right now. And I think that you've got to start building up Riddick's confidence again. So I'm expecting from here on out more Riddick than Smith starting.
Yeah, I'd kind of see like 7 games for one of the goalies and 6 for the other. you know, and split kind of evenly.
Yeah, I think you'll probably play till you lose at this point, honestly. It's not necessarily what I would do, but I can see the coaches just play them till they lose.
Yeah. Well, like, I could see Riddick playing tomorrow, and then, like, say, Smith against the Rangers, Riddick against the Jets, and then the other guy against the Blue Jackets, and, like, just kind of alternating
a
bit.
We've really got 3 games a week. What if you, I mean, outside the back-to-back, what if you were to give each guy a week?
That would possibly work. It just depends, really, on how, like, I'd be taking it more game-to-game and seeing how each guy responds, frankly. And it's one of those things that each guy has looked really good at times and then has had a game where it's like, dude, what are you doing? So,
but show me a goalie who hasn't.
Oh, I know. But you're getting a lot more of the what are you doing type of games lately, and that's not ideal. So we'll see. I think that'll be split pretty evenly, though.
Well, looking at the standings right now, Calgary still sits number one in the Pacific, and actually number one in the West still. They have 91 points. They're one game up.
And that'll change in about 20 minutes. San Jose's up 2-0 in the third period.
Are
so.
They? Okay, so as of right now, the Flames have 91 points. San Jose has 90, so you're saying they'll jump up to first with 92 and even games played.
Yeah.
I said this last show, I think. I'm pretty sure I said it on the air, but I really think we're going to be in this cat and mouse game with them, constantly chasing each other right up till the 31st. And I think that game on the 31st is going to be probably the most meaningful game that we have remaining, because I think the team that wins that is going to win the Pacific.
Could very well be. And
I think the team that wins that will win the West.
Yeah. Well, honestly, I don't think any of the teams below Calgary or San Jose.
I mean, Winnipeg's at 84. They got a ways to go.
Yeah, and I don't see them being like 8 points better type of thing than us over the last 13 games. Like, that's
no,
or San Jose. Like, things would have to go weird for Winnipeg to win the West, where like Calgary and San Jose both just suck for a while. You know, and I just don't.
So that's my prediction, is that San Jose game is what seals it.
Yeah. Yep.
So with that, Matt, big question we asked on Twitter is always, what do people want to talk about? And even before I asked, I'd put into our show notes for this week, is it time to break up the purple Gatorade line? Is it time for Sean Monahan and Johnny Gaudreau to go their separate ways and play on different lines, see other people? What do you think? Do the Flames keep that line going? Do they break it up? What do you think?
I think for now you keep them going, just because of the fact that you need to get them going. And because, like, if you break it up, you're basically screwing all of the chemistry throughout the lineup. And with the 3M line playing well yesterday, like, the third and fourth line are always, like, the last, like, 15, 20 games, the third and fourth line have been awesome, frankly. So, like, you're not wanting to mess up them. So, like, it's really hard to switch things up without breaking the team a bit. And
based on the lines we saw yesterday against Vegas, what if you were to just swap Gaudreau and Tkachuk?
Honestly, I don't see that really helping Gaudreau, because he doesn't fit the style of game that Backlund or Frolik play. You'd almost have to throw Gaudreau with Jankowski and Zarnik and move Bennett up to the line with Backlund and Frolik.
See, that's the thing. You can't make, like, I just threw that in there because I knew it wouldn't work. You can't just make a one-for-one swap. You got to shift them all.
Yeah.
I would actually put Gaudreau. You and I have seen some good preseason chemistry in the past with Gaudreau and Bennett. I'd actually go Gaudreau, Bennett, Jankowski.
Yeah, that could work. I've also thought of maybe doing something a little weird with the first line of swapping Monahan out to be a right winger and moving Lindholm into the center position.
Why?
Monahan seems to be a little off, and more so than any of the other players. And I think, because Lindholm is such a good defensive player, that swapping him out to be the center might allow Monahan some more flexibility to generate offense and get himself into offensive situations where you can rely on Lindholm to be the defensively oriented guy more so.
I don't know that swapping their positions is going to help all that much.
Yeah.
I think if you want to do that, you move Monahan out then.
Yeah.
To a different line. I mean, there's talk that Monty's hurt. And to me, if Monty's hurt, sit him down. Like, you know, I would rather we sit him and let him rest than screw him up for a long playoff run.
Yeah. Well, it depends on the type of injury as well. Like, if it's one that's not going to get any better, you're pretty much just got to run with what you got. And, yeah.
Yeah, I agree with you. I don't see them getting any benefit by changing out this line. I think these guys have chemistry together, and by changing the line, you're really just making change for the sake of change. I think the best way to keep them going is to keep them together because they have that chemistry. And if you, say, put Goudreau on a different line or Monahan on a different line, they're going to have to learn all new chemistry, and you're not going to get going when you're trying to work with new guys.
Yeah, exactly. And that's more likely just to mess up other lines than it is to help that. And, you know, like, maybe you promote the 3M line to being the first line and put the Goudreau line as the second line instead.
See, I could see doing that. I could see maybe giving the second, and let's call it the second line being the 3M line, and let's call the third line the Bennett, Jankowski, Zarnik line. I could see those two lines playing your first and second minutes. And maybe give Goudreau, Monahan, Lindholm your third line minutes for a game or two. Maybe they just need a little bit less play time.
Yeah. Still have them on PP1, but, you know, just...
less 5-on-5.
Exactly.
Yeah, so I think for me, that's the way I would go instead of breaking up that line. I'm not sure that's going to be useful at this point. I do think we'll see some of those guys subbed out as we get closer to the playoffs, but... you know, I don't see them switching the lineups and moving those guys in and out. I just think somebody will be sitting as we get closer to the playoffs.
Yeah.
I can see those three games in April, Goudreau and Monahan not playing.
Well, it depends on...
it depends where they're at.
Yeah, like if they've clinched the playoffs like first in the conference by then sure. But I think that until... like, that's been decided one way or the other. I think
you gotta
that
keep him in the
everybody,
lineup.
Yeah, because I think it's more imperative, frankly, to win the conference than to rest anybody. And
I'm just going on the assumption that we're going to beat San Jose on the 31st, and that's the clincher.
Yeah. We'll see. There's a lot of hockey left to play, and hopefully San Jose trails off a bit over the next little bit.
The other thing about the Goudreau and Monahan Lindholm line is I think that they performed better than we realistically expected them to all season. So, you know, I don't want to say that they're out of gas, but they've probably used more gas than we expected them to already. So they just need to find that way to recharge. And whether that's sleeping at home, you know, in their own beds, whatever that might be, they've been great so far. I think you have to look at their body of work, not in the last week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks, but over the entire season so far. And with what they've done, yeah, they don't look great now, but they've earned the right to stay together in my books.
Yeah, I agree.
You know, it's not like we just put them together for the first time and they sucked. These guys are really who've been carrying the team all season.
I agree.
So they don't look good for 3 weeks.
Yep. And hopefully that they break out of that sooner than later and everything gets right with the world.
And, you know, that's maybe the luxury of being first, right? Is you can say, oh, our first line's not performing. It's okay. We don't have a cushion now. We're down. But, you know, you're still pretty close to the top where you can still fight back.
Yeah. And, like, looking ahead to San Jose's schedule, like, by the time we record next, they play Winnipeg, Florida, Nashville, and Vegas. So, three really tough opponents for them this week. So, if the Flames, if they can beat New Jersey, New York, and they do also play Winnipeg, if they can win that game as well, then, like, the Flames might have, like, another 3-4 point cushion ahead again for next week. So, it just depends on how each of these teams play.
You know, as much as we kind of, I think we both enjoyed having the Flames number one undisputed for a while, it's fun to be in this kind of a battle with San Jose, you know? Like, we push, they push, we push, they push. It's it's an interesting way to end the season.
I would much rather have an easy cushion, thank you.
I don't disagree, but I mean, there. Let's just say there hasn't been a lot of adversarial storylines that we've seen this year.
No.
And it's nice to have a little bit of that now down the stretch.
True. It's just that, you know, like, I'm looking ahead to the postseason, and please, you know, not lose to Vegas in the first round. Like, after all of this season, you know, like, that would suck, you know.
we'll get there when we get there.
Oh, I know. That would just really suck, though.
Well, talking about the playoffs, some potential playoff depth possibly coming back. Michael Stone got activated from the IR last week and sent down to Stockton on a conditioning stint. He played 3 games during that time.
Was a +7?
+7.
Really good.
He registered 2 assists in his time with the Heat and was paired with Renat Valiev. While he was there, he last played in the NHL on November 11th. He's played 11 games so far, as 4 assists for 4 total points and a -1 with where he's at. So, good guy to come back. Glad they brought him back up to the team. Where do you think Stone's going to fit into the team right now? Do you think he slots in the starting 6? Do you think he'll be an extra defenseman? And who would you put as his partner?
I'm going to give a weird suggestion and say that for one of the, like, whenever Stone is 100% and ready to go, sit TJ Brody for a game and put Anderson with Giordano and have Fantenberg and Stone being the third pairing.
Okay. Why would you do that?
TJ Brody has frankly been kind of bad for the last few weeks, and I think that he could use a game off to recoup himself a bit. There's just too many mistakes that he shouldn't be making, frankly, and the Flames need him to be at his best if the Flames are actually wanting to win in the postseason. And I think having him rest for a game would be a good way to go about it. And I think having Stone in there with Fantenberg is a decent third pairing. And you want to see how those two guys interact in case you want to not have the kids play at all during the postseason.
I agree with Gio and Anderson. I can't see them sitting Brody. So if it was me, I would go Gio Anderson, Hanifin Hamonic, and Stone Brody as the third pairing. We've seen some success with those two in the past as well.
Yeah, I could see that as well.
I just can't see them sitting TJ Brody, like you said, unless they're clinched or something. Maybe just giving them reduced minutes, like we were talking about with the first line, might help sort of get over some of whatever he's going through.
Yeah. And speaking of Fantenberg, he's been just quietly really good since...
Good acquisition.
Yeah. Like, I noticed that there was a couple of plays where, like, he just stood up the Vegas guy coming in with the puck and just disrupted him enough that it caused a turnover. Just very subtle things like that, but very important moving forward. And, like, he doesn't have a lot of offensive flash to him, but frankly, for a third pairing guy, you're not really wanting anything dynamic down there anyway. And he's just very responsible defensively. Like, I'd be glad if the Flames could sign him for 3 or 4 years if he can continue to play like this for the longer
term.
He's
really your epitome of a number 6.
Yeah, he reminds me a lot of Derek Englund. Just someone who is solid, gets his job done right. No problems, no complaints. Just goes out there, does his thing. Awesome. And so I'm really liking that acquisition. I'm still frankly shocked that LA traded him, but can't complain. And hopefully the Flames can keep him for a while because he's doing a really good job. And I think that would solidify things, especially if the Flames did make a move in the offseason and moved out a defenseman or something like that, that they could have him play on a regular, and you'd be, you know, if he plays like this, like, you don't mind him being the number 6 for a long while.
Yeah, I don't disagree. I think Fantenberg, he looked better than I expected him to. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, I was kind of expecting him to be like the number three for LA while they did their rebuild. And so, like, I was kind of shocked that they traded him in the first place. But, you know, their loss is our gain, hopefully. And hopefully we can keep him for the longer term just because of the fact that he seems just to be a really solid guy out there. And you need that. And, you know, not everybody needs to be an all-star. Sometimes you just need someone who gets the job done. And
not everybody can be the star. Some people need to be the supporting cast, right?
Yep. And he does his thing really well, and hopefully he can carry that into the playoffs. And frankly, I would expect him to be playing in the playoffs and sitting one of the kids instead.
Just based on the timing of the recall, I don't think we will see Stone sit out tomorrow. I think that Stone will be in the lineup against New Jersey.
Yeah, I could see that.
I don't think you call him up so quickly if you're not planning to put him in the lineup.
Well, the Flames actually had to, because you're only allowed a three-game or, I think, six-day conditioning stint.
I think he had
like
another
that, so.
Game or two that he could have played down there, though.
Yeah.
Like, I would have left him down there for the maximum amount of time otherwise.
Yeah. Well,
maybe he got
we'll
sick
see.
Of the bus.
Yeah, we'll see. Hopefully they can get him in sometime this week, and hopefully he has a good game or two in him.
He goes from flying on the jet with the NHL team to sitting at home with a blood clot to riding the bus in the AHL. Now he's back to flying on the jet.
Yep.
So, yeah, I can see him going in tomorrow, who his partner is. I can see it being Fattenberg. I don't necessarily see him taking Anderson out of lineup, though, nor Brody. So I think, like I said, the most logical would be put him with Brody. I think if you look at Peters, too, he tends to like to bring guys back after an injury in a bigger role than when they left.
Yeah.
Like, I can see him putting him with Brody to kind of say, okay, we're giving you a top, you know, partner, show us if you can keep up.
Yeah, exactly. And
I
think
we've seen that a few times this season as guys have come out of the lineup and back in.
Yeah, and I think that he needs to show that, hey, I can play like an actual game instead of being a high quality number seven. And like, if he can show that, like, he deserves to be playing each game, then that'll be great. It's just, you know, that's one of the good and bad things with having like nine NHL defensemen, is that you can only play six, and he needs to show that he can be one of those six. And it'll be interesting to see what they do to get other guys ice time. Like, I wouldn't even be shocked if they tried Shillington up as a forward for a game.
You say this every season. There's always some defenseman you want them to make a forward, and they never do. Give it up, Matt.
Yeah, well,
it's England, it's Fanouf, it's you always want the defenseman to play forward.
Yeah, well,
you might as well just trade a winger and promote one of our defensemen.
Exactly. Who needs that Goudreau? We got Shillington.
What I honestly see happening is sort of like the goaltenders, and we were saying that they're going to rotate. I think you're going to see Giordano, Brody, Hanifin, Hamonic, Anderson, and mystery partner every night. And I think it'll rotate between Stone, Fattenberg, and Shillington.
Yeah. Actually, I dropped Shillington. I don't think he sees the ice again this season.
You don't think so?
No.
Why not demote him then?
They can't.
It's true.
He was up after the All-Star trade deadline, so they actually can't assign him down.
And it makes it interesting, too, because a lot of people are waiting for Valimaki to get recalled. And right now, I don't think I would recall him until the regular season's over. Like, there's no room for him.
Exactly. Like, honestly, unless
there's an injury.
Yeah, they'd have to be, like, three injuries, really.
Well, that's it. Even with one injury, you've tried to fill it internally.
Yeah, because, like, say one of the top four guys, you just have Stone or Fattenberg play up, and there you go. You know, like, you're pretty much good.
And Stone, I think Stone would be the guy that could probably shoulder those minutes, or at least from what we've seen.
Yeah.
But yeah, you're right. I think, you know, Valimaki, I think there will be a bunch of guys like Dubé, Valimaki, who get called up as the Black Aces for the playoffs, but I don't see any of them getting ice time.
No, not unless they get into like an 0-4 injury bug type run where like they had Brennan Evans playing.
He's a free agent. I looked it up. So is my Commodore. I still have my red Commodore wig on the shelf over here.
Oh, that's great.
We can make some free agent acquisitions.
Yes.
But yeah, so I see Stone. I honestly can see Stone playing both of the New Jersey and New York games. I think that they want to get them going quickly and see what they've got in them.
Oh, and it makes sense. Just like with the goalies having to determine which guy is going to be the guy in the playoffs, you need to figure out which of the top eight that you have currently, who are going to be the top six in the playoffs.
Yep, you sure do. And it's, you know, it's a nice thing to have to figure out. I mean, for so long we've talked about how this team has been poor on the defensive depth. And I mean, right now, if you include Valimaki, we have defensemen we don't have a home for. And so I think, as you've mentioned, it's pretty obvious that the Flames are going to have to move at least one of them in the offseason.
Yeah, which that sucks because they're awesome, but, you know, you only have six spots.
Well, we say it sucks, but if you look at what kind of return you'd probably get for the guy I think we both think is leaving, it's probably not going to suck.
Yeah.
It's not like the Jerome deal where we're trading them for pennies on the dollar.
Yeah.
Especially if we can go deep, you're going to get a better return on these guys.
Yeah, it's like, hey, New Jersey, we'd like Taylor Hall just to stick it to Edmonton. What do you guys think? Okay, sure.
Or call Edmonton. Hey, you want to trade a defenseman for a forward again?
Yeah.
But, like these guys who go deep tend to be worth more, maybe overvalued after a deep playoff run. So this might be the year to make those kind of deals.
Oh, for sure. And, like, a guy like Brody has, I think that, like, if the Flames trade anybody, it'll be him. Just because of the fact that he's a free agent after next season. And
I agree.
His age and all that. And he is a top-pairing defenseman on one of the best teams in the league. So, you know, like, that will, you'll get a lot for him. And, you know, just for asset management's sake, that makes the most sense.
If you think about that deal and what we might get, and then what I think is going to happen in the draft floor, which is revisiting the Frolik for Zucker deal, this team could walk out of draft day with not only a bunch of young players for once and not having to move a top pick, but a very different look to their forward group.
I agree. And it'll be interesting to see, especially with how things shake out, like what direction the team takes. Because, like, say the Flames struggle the rest of the way, like, not necessarily are bad, but they just do not finish first, and then they lose to Vegas in the first round. Well, a lot's going to have to change, because, like, obviously there's a problem with the team, and like, it'll need to be fixed. And, you know, it's one of those situations where the Flames are in a bit of a weird spot where they have a lot of chips that they can play depending on what the situation ends up being. And, like, if the Flames go on a long run, then you don't necessarily need to go to the same extent as you would if things, like, crash and burn. Frankly.
Well, but even look at last year. They moved Hamilton, and they got really a key piece that's put us in first. So I think you could make a similar type of deal moving, you know, TJ Brody.
I agree.
You know, if you really look at it as, if you kind of take one piece for one piece, you move, say, Brody in a prospect, you could get a Lindholm-type player.
Oh, for sure. And, yeah, definitely. There's plenty of guys out there that... There's plenty of teams that... Like, they might have, like, five or six really good forwards and, like, one or two good defensemen. So a guy like Brody is, you know, obviously going to be important to them, where Calgary is like, we have four guys under the age of 22 that are doing awesome, so we need to, you know, go a different direction. So we'll see. It'll be interesting to see. Like, I'm curious to see how the season ends for the Flames and the postseason, how that goes. And I think that will determine a lot of what the Flames do. And, you know, I think that depending on how, like, if things do screw up, in what manner does it screw up? And you know, like, is it a situation like Brian Elliott from a couple of years ago where the goaltending just nukes the team? Or, like, does the forward group be bad? Or, you know, like, it depends on, like, what direction things, like, if they do screw up, what way does it happen? And, you know, I think that'll go a long way to determine the corresponding moves on the other end.
Well, knock on wood, let's hope we don't screw up.
True. You know, like, I'm hoping that the Flames can go 2 or 3 or 4 rounds.
You and I
deep.
Are both hoping for a deep year this year.
Yeah. But, you know, if they're playing Vegas in the first round, that's a pretty much a coin toss.
It'll be a fun series, though. I mean, as much as the Flames are going to have a hard time, it'll be fun to watch.
Yeah. And, like, honestly, I'm not sure that the Flames come out on top in that series. And, you know, it will probably be a 6 or 7 game series either way. And, you know, it's, like, especially, like, after how good this season was, you know, like, if that's, you know, they end up losing in the first round, I think that would be quite, I think that may actually even be more disappointing than last season, frankly. So, we'll see. You know, and I think that, similarly, that things will change. But, you know, you gotta look at, like, historically, teams don't typically go from, like, no playoff experience to, like, being in the cup finals or
winning the cup. I've said all year I don't think they're going to win the cup or even necessarily make the finals, but I still think if they can make it past round one, it's a success.
Yeah.
We've got enough time with this core. We can do it again next year, and I think, as we just talked about, they can still beef things up quite a bit. And I think that this will, you know, we need to put some solid footing in and get some playoff experience for these guys. But just looking around the league, I don't think it's our year.
No. And, like, you look at, like, even the rest of the teams in the West, like, there's nobody that's as well suited to emerging as a perennial contender over the next few years than Calgary. Because, like, San Jose's kind of old, and, like, a lot of their good players are free agents. Winnipeg's pretty much near the cap. They can't really afford anything else. Nashville, same thing. St. Louis is kind of in that middling range as well, and, like, everybody else is kind of bad or trending downward. So, like, Calgary, like, for the next 2, 3, 4 seasons will be one of the top 3 teams in the West. And, you know, just depends on, like, if they can get the experience this year, that will lend them more of a chance to, say, be a contender for the Cup or a realistic Stanley Cup champion next year or the year after. And it just depends a lot on what they do this year will kind of dictate moving forward what moves to have to be made to take those next steps.
Yeah, I think, you know, there's definitely going to be a playoff run. I don't want to talk about who we will or won't be playing until that's settled. We could sit here and speculate for hours. But, you know, let's wait and see as we get closer who our opponent's going to be, and then I think that'll give us a better outlook on how long we think these guys might last.
Yeah, well, it'll either be Vegas if we don't win the division, or it'll be Dallas, Minnesota, Arizona, or Colorado if we do.
Which is a big spread.
Yeah, because all of those teams are between 72 and 75 points, so it's kind of hard to say, oh, we're playing you. You know, it's...
So let's wait and see once we firm that up.
Yeah. But, you know, all of the teams in that second group all kind of suck for various reasons. So, like, Colorado has good offense, but nothing else.
Well, if you're Arizona's... a team that's in that position, you're not a great team. That's why you're in that position, right?
Yeah. Arizona's just kind of there. Like, they don't really have anything on either end of the puck, but, you know, they're just there. Minnesota's kind of in the rebuild of their own, and Dallas has Ben and Sagan and Bishop, and that's it. So, yeah, we'll see. You know, like, the Flames would be far better suited playing any of those 4 teams than they would Vegas. But, you know, it depends on how they do the rest of the way. And if they
and
can...
maybe that's the motivator that Bill Peters uses to win the division.
Yeah. Because, you know, like, if you look at any of those four teams, the Flames should take any of them out in six games or less. And they could even sweep, like, if they go up against Colorado, I'd probably expect that one to be more of a sweep category than anything. Whereas Vegas, that's going to be a six or seven game dogfight, and we might not win that. So,
well, let's talk about that when we get there, shall we?
Oh, for sure.
Let's take a break from Calgary for a bit. Let's go down south to Stockton. And through 31 games with Stockton this year, Dubé's registered 37 points and leads all AHL rookies at 1.19 points per game. So they're looking really good this year. A couple quick hits for them. The Heat have now registered 8 shorthanded goals over the past 8 games, with 3 from Ryan Lomberg, 2 from Dubé, and 1 each from Renat Valiev, Glenn Godden, and Buddy Robinson. The club now leads the AHL in shorties on the year with 16. The Heat snapped an 18-game win streak for Bakersfield over on Friday, and that dates back to January 11th. Can you imagine if we went on an 18-game win streak?
Yeah. Well, the question I have to ask is, who is the better team, the Bakersfield Condors or their parent team, the Edmonton Oilers?
You know what I've always thought would be cool, and I just want to segue here. I've always thought it'd be neat at the end of training camp to do like a scrimmage of Flames versus Stockton.
Yeah.
And that could be the ultimate test right there.
Okay, boys, whoever wins, you're the team next year.
Well, but you know what I mean? Like, if you have, like, the NHL guys playing against the rookies, it would give the rookies a chance to show what they can do.
Yeah, and honestly, I think Bakersfield would probably win that game, even if the Oilers had McDavid, but, you know.
I don't know who's on the Bakersfield roster, or even who their goalie is.
That doesn't matter.
Stockton's
Who's on the Oilers roster besides Draisaitl, Nugent Hopkins, and McDavid? Like, really?
Chris Russell.
Oh, how could I forget?
And what's his name? Koskinen, the most expensive backup in the league.
Yes. And that guy over there who wears the number.
The guy with the hockey pants.
Yes.
And the stick.
Yeah, that's the one.
Stockton's won 5 of its last 6 home games with victories over all 4 teams currently in the playoff position in the Pacific Division. John Gillies is actually looking a lot better. We talked about how he's struggled since the beginning of the year. He's gotten the nod between the pipes in 11 of the last 12 games, winning 7 and earning at least a point in 8 of them. And Spencer Fu has 6 points, 1 goal and 5 assists in Stockton's last 3 games. And as we mentioned earlier, in 3 games of his conditioning stint, Michael Stone had 2 assists and was a plus 7. So I would love to see Stockton in the playoffs, because I think the more you can get these guys learning how to win at every level, the better the team is. But I don't know. It's going to be a fight for these guys to get in. They've been quite low all year. They're making a break now, and I'm wondering if it's too little too late.
Yeah, I think it is. I think they're like 7 or 8 points out of a playoff spot right now. Not that much left to go in the season, so I don't think they'll make it unless they win out, and they'd pretty much have to at this point. One thing of note with Dylan Dubé, he's only 1 of 7 players in the last, I think, 15 years to have more than 1.1 point per game as a player under the age of 20 in the AHL. So, or 20 or under, I mean. And so, and 4 of those guys ended up becoming, like, top players in the NHL. So, that's fairly impressive. So, hopefully he can turn the corner at moving forward and maybe emerge as a higher quality NHL player.
Well, and I mean, we don't speculate where he'll fit now. We can do that in the offseason. But if you look at the Flames forward group right now and you go, where do you slot Dubé in? Like, as we talked about before, there's going to have to be some moves made if you want to slot some of these guys in.
Well, that's the thing. And with having so many high-quality players, you can kind of package 2 of them up for 1 really good player. And I think that's what you're going to end up seeing is, like, say, like, Brody and, say, Jankowski or Bennett or something like that for, like, insert top-line caliber forward here and allow guys like Mangiapane, Dubé, Phillips, Valimaki, Shillington to fill those spots on both the forward and defensive side of things and allow the Flames not only to get better but have high-end replacements. And that's not something that we've had of late, is the high-end replacements.
Very true. Just going back to what you're saying about Stockton and where they are, they sit at 56 points right now with 11 games remaining, and it looks like Colorado is the last Pacific team in a playoff position, and they have 64 points right now with 12 games remaining. So we're, what, 8 points out? It's going to be a push in 11 games to get 8 points, but we'll see if they can do it.
Yeah, they'd pretty much have to win all 11 and then hope that Colorado sucks for a bit.
And even then, with a team that's, you know, really come up late like they have, I don't even think they would go very deep. I mean, it'd be good to get a round or two, but I don't think you get much more out of them this year.
No. It'd be 4-0 probably, or 5-0, something like that.
And there's pros, 'cause
they'd have to play Bakersfield, I think. So, like, they're going to get slaughtered if that happens.
Maybe we can get them to just play Edmonton.
Well, then they'd win. But, you know, that unfortunately isn't how it happens.
That's true. There's no relegation.
Yep.
A couple listener questions we had this week. As always, we ask on Twitter, our Twitter account is at Fireside Podcast. What do you guys want us to talk about this week? And JD Nimmo, or Jonathan Nimmo on Twitter, we've answered his question a few times lately, asked us, what's your opinion on the Lazar call-up? They bring him up, don't play him, and then send him down again. Especially when we're not playing well, surely you could have got a shot or have stayed down. Matt, why don't you take this first?
Lazar, I think with him, practice matters. And like, if he's not showing to be better than any of the alternates, and especially with the fact that the third and fourth lines have looked really well over the last like month and a bit, like, who do you take out? Like, you can't put, unless you're taking Frolik out of the lineup, that's realistically the only spot that he could go. Do you want to put Lazar on the second line? No, nobody does. So, you know, everybody else is doing really good for where they are in the lineup. There's just no room for him, unfortunately, and it sucks for him, but it's a numbers game, and he's been the 13th forward, and he didn't get any action because he's the 13th forward.
He was called up just for the deadline, right?
A little bit before that.
Yeah, I think they called him up anticipating they might be doing something and just needed a body on deadline day or the day after, because they played the day before and the day after. I think the team thought they were probably in on the Stone deal and would have to move a couple bodies to make it work. So I really think that that's why Lazar was brought up.
Yeah.
Not a bad guy. I mean, we know that they did a little bit of paperwork there to use one of their post-deadline call-ups on him. And I agree with you. If the team wasn't looking good, especially that bottom six, I think you would have slotted him in somewhere. But the bottom six is what's been keeping the Flames going for the last little bit. You can't put him in. And I think some of it was probably just seen as work ethic, seeing how things have changed. They really haven't seen him this year since training camp, the coaching staff here. So bring him up, see what he's got. I don't think we've seen the last of Lazar this season. I think if we clinch, you could see him back up here in the lineup even. But I think he's one of the guys that the Stockton Heat could probably do without for a bit, and that's why he was brought up as a body.
Yeah.
But I still believe he was brought up because they thought they'd have to move a couple roster players, and he was the extra body they thought they'd need.
Yeah, I agree. And he would have been perfect. Like, if the third and fourth line had just been playing like the average third and fourth line, then I think Lazar has played like 3 or 4 games by now. But because of the fact that they've basically been the main players on the team for the last month and a half, what do? You know, you can't rest the guys that are actually winning you games.
Well, if I look at it, I thought, okay, he'll go in instead of Zarnik, and then Zarnik starts looking good. And I think he'll go in instead of Mangiapane, and Mangiapane starts looking good. So, like you said, who do you take out of lineup to put him in? And as far as I can see it, you're not going to put him in for Frolik, I don't think. So yeah, there was just no room for him.
Yeah, it sucks for him, but that's part of the problem when you have a really good team, that you know, you have to be better than everybody else, and if they're all firing on all cylinders, you're not going anywhere, no matter what you try to do.
A friend of mine said he got Wotherspoon. You remember there was that one season they brought Tyler Wotherspoon up like three times and didn't play him?
Yeah.
And then the other question we got here from Kevin Olenek, who we've had on the show, at KevOl on Twitter, asked three questions. Two of them I think we've already answered. Split Monty and Goudreau, we talked about that. How much should Stone play? We've talked about that. And the last one is they sent Lazar down and brought Quine up. Alan Quine got brought back. He looked good when he was here last time. And Kevin's asking, will they play Quine? And I think for me, the answer is the same. If the third and fourth line keep looking the way they are, there's no reason to put Quine in there. I see why they want an extra body right now, because you know, they're without Neil, so they need to carry somebody. And I think they're trying to send Lazar back down for a bit of a playoff push in Stockton. So I will answer this by saying, if the lineup stays the way it is and the same players that are looking good and healthy stay the same, I don't think Quine plays. If anybody gets hurt or has a couple miserable games, I think Quine goes in.
Yep, I agree.
And not just anybody. Anyone on the bottom six, I should qualify.
Yeah. I agree.
Yeah, I think Quine is one of those veteran guys. We even saw it when he came up before. He's played enough NHL time that I think he can transition to a bottom six quite easily. And I think until James Neal comes back, you're going to see them carrying that extra body. Especially, you know, being in Calgary, it takes a little bit to get anyone here from Stockton.
Yeah, and he's also a player that has some playoff success. He scored a goal in overtime to beat the Panthers a couple years ago, so you know, like, he can rise to that level if given the opportunity, and so it makes sense that in a playoff push like we're having, that having a guy who's not only been there but had success in a late season push is probably a better option than Lazar as well.
Well, and has also shown success here this year. Like, Lazar, we're going back to what he's done in the past. Quine's come up. He's looked good this year. So you got to reward that. And I think if either Mangiapane or, let's say, Mangiapane or Zarnik don't look as good, I think he goes in.
Yep.
You agree?
I agree wholeheartedly.
Well, I think that's it for the week, and I think all we have to do is look ahead to the week that's coming. Anything else you want to chat about before we do?
No, let's see what's coming up.
So the Flames have three games on the docket before we talk next. Two at home and a quick road trip up to Winnipeg. So Tuesday night, they take on New Jersey. That's a 7 p.m. start time at the Saddle Dome. Then they have 2 days off, and on Friday night, they take on the New York Rangers, another 7 p.m. start time at the Saddle Dome. And Saturday night, they make a quick trip to Winnipeg, 5 p.m. start time on Saturday. So that's a bit of a weird one. We're used to 8 p.m. starts.
Yeah, if you look at the standings, New Jersey has 59 points in 69 games, and the Rangers have 68 points in 68 games. So both of those teams well out of a playoff spot. The Rangers are 11 points out, and the Devils are 20 points out, so like, they're done. And then you have Winnipeg, who has 84. So really only one tough team this week, but the Flames need to go out and put the two teams away that they need to, and then, you know, hopefully get two against Winnipeg as well.
Before I make our predictions, what do you think the goalie situation is going to look like for this week?
Smith twice and Riddick once.
You think Smith plays the two homers and Riddick's the road goalie?
I'd probably go Smith versus New Jersey, then Riddick against the Rangers and Smith against the Jets.
Okay. I have a feeling they like to run these guys in consecutive games. So I think they're going to do Smith, New Jersey, and New York. I think there's less pressure there for Smith. And I can see them wanting to test Riddick a bit in the Winnipeg game.
Yeah, I could see that.
So that's my prediction. My prediction of the week, I think they're going to win the two games against the East and lose to Winnipeg. I think they'll beat New Jersey, beat the Rangers, and lose to Winnipeg.
I'm going to be a little more bold. Win, win, win.
If the Winnipeg game wasn't a back-to-back for us, I think it'd be a win. But I don't know. The Flames aren't doing well with their back-to-backs this year.
Well, they'll buck the trend.
Hopefully. I hope so.
Yes.
The Winnipeg one's really the game we need because it's points against a Western opponent.
Yeah, who's actually somewhat relevant.
Yeah, so you know that's the one they really need, but that's the one I think they're going to lose. But I think they can sort of make up for it by getting 4 points on the week.
Yeah, because like if you look past this week, the next six games are against Columbus, Ottawa, Vancouver, LA, Dallas, and Anaheim. Like, not a lot of high-end teams there. So if the Flames can get on a bit of a roll this week, especially beating the first two opponents, if they can win those ones, maybe they can go on more of a protracted roll and maybe win six or seven or maybe even eight of the next nine games, which I think they'll need to do in order to...
Yeah, I don't know. I'm looking ahead here. It's kind of weird because we play LA and Anaheim here. They've done a lot of this season where we almost were there and then the next week they're here or vice versa. Like we saw that with Vegas. But I think next week we're going to struggle with Columbus and I can see them having a hard time with the Canucks. So I'm hoping they'll pick up some wins this week.
Yeah. Oh, Columbus has kind of struggled ever since they went nuts at the deadline buying everybody.
Yeah, so, I don't know. I think Calgary's going to underestimate them and maybe it'll cost them, but we'll see.
Well, the game's in Calgary, so they don't have to worry about the cannon, so that's always good.
Yeah, I don't know. I can see Bobrovsky just coming out strong in that one, and I mean, we've had a lot of games, like even the game in Vegas, I think, you know, it was Fleury that really, you know, kept that one close for them. I can see Bobrovsky, but we'll talk about it next Monday, but I can see Bobrovsky coming out and really being a thorn in the Flames' side.
Very well could be.
Well, Matt, I think that's about it for this week. The Flames got their win that they needed last night, and let's hope it continues because they really can't afford another four-game losing streak.
No, they really do need to go on a more protracted winning phase. Like, not necessarily winning every single game, but you, like 7 of 9 the next nine or 8 of the next 9 would be ideal.
And even those games they lose, they still got to be looking good.
Yeah, exactly. They need to get their stuff together so that way when they face the Sharks at the end of the month, that like that might be the end of the Sharks season.
Let's hope so.
In terms of the playoff structure. So hopefully that's the case, but the Flames just need to take care of their own business.
Let's hope so, Matt. You have a good week.
Thank you, everyone.
And I'll talk to you next week.
Yep. Go Flames, go.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson. Co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.